Well, good evening. Glad to have everyone here again. My name is Jerry Zare. I'm the pastor at Carmel Christian Church, which is right across from the high school, and I'm also the president of the Carmel Interfaith Alliance. This is a coalition of Greek Orthodox, Roman Catholic, Christian Scientist, Mormon, Hindu, Sikh, Baha'i now, Hindu, Muslim, Jewish traditions, faith communities in our city. And we are so fortunate to have the support of the mayor. And this series is in partnership with the Human Relations Commission from the city as well. The mayor has been very supportive of the diversity of our city and what we're doing. Barbara, who's been on the Human Relations Commission, there's a little pamphlet for them. They provided all the refreshments for us. It's been a wonderful series. And if you haven't been able to be at all these, they will be on video. They're being videotaped. And they'll be on the Carmel Interfaith Alliance Facebook page, and then also probably be at the city. So if you're on the email list, I'll be sending that out to everyone. I think most of you have been on the email, and you've heard about, I sent out a notice about the Interfaith Thanksgiving service. That's going to be on November 18th, Sunday at 4:30, and it's going to be at the Jewish Temple here in Carmel. And especially after the vandalism and the swastikas that were put on and the support that we had, it's going to be wonderful to be there at the synagogue. We have just some wonderful singers from some of our different congregations, and from Hindu, from Protestant, and Islamic call to worship, a cantor from the Jewish tradition as well. So you'll have a whole diverse experience that evening. Next week is our last week, and Muzaffar will be the speaker with the Islamic tradition. And so that's always a very interesting, and we hope that you can come for that tomorrow night. We are so fortunate to have three folks who are with us, and I'd like to introduce them. This is Father Lucas. Father Lucas is right out of seminary. He's been here 2 years now, but he is with the Holy Trinity Greek Orthodox Cathedral. And if before it was church, but they have just been identified from the bishop as a cathedral. It's the only cathedral in Indiana, which also, you many of you realize, we only have the only Mormon temple in Indiana is in Carmel. The only Hindu temple in Indiana is on German Road in Indianapolis. So we are very fortunate to have some opportunities. If you've never been over to the Greek Orthodox Church, it's a wonderful, beautiful facility, beautiful service. So Father Lucas, Lori Bienavauer, who is from St. Peter's United Church of Christ, she's been a part of our group from the beginning days. And so we're so glad to have her sharing some of the Protestant background. And Sharon Jackson, who is a practitioner with the Christian Church Scientist. And she also has been a part of our interfaith community. So we are looking forward to this time together. And we're going to begin by, so let's first just welcome all three of them and give them our thanks for being here tonight.
I have to get my handout here. This handout is the one with the blue arrow. It's about 2,000 years of history compressed into several pages and 10 minutes. I'm watching the clock. I'm not going to get into the particularities. Can you all hear me all right? Yes, okay. I'm not going to get into the particularities of the timeline that much because you have it and you can look at it. Isn't that nice? And if we go down the list, I'll fall asleep, you'll fall asleep, nobody will have a very good time. So I'll just make some highlighted comments about it. We talk about, we may hear Orthodox or Greek Orthodox or Russian Orthodox. We also hear Roman Catholic. We hear Coptic. All of these churches have a common root and a common history. In 33 AD, most of us, if we're familiar with the story of the beginning of Christianity, in 33 AD, we have a celebration of what the Greek Jews called Pentecosti, or Pentecost, the 50th day after Passover. And at Pentecost, whole bunches of people are in Jerusalem. And in 33 AD, I'm using conventional dating, by the way. So for those of you timeline scholars who are saying, ah, but the calendar's off by 2 or 3 years, I know. But in about 33 AD, they're celebrating Pentecost or Shavuos in Jerusalem, and everybody's coming. All of the Jews from all of the known world are coming because this is what you do. And the apostles are preaching about this promised one, this Christ, this anointed one who has died and risen again. They've seen him, they've encountered him, and the Holy Spirit comes upon them. They begin preaching in multiple languages that are understood by the people there. So if you know the story from Acts, that's all review. Great. So they don't stop there. They go out into the entire world. They go beyond the bounds of the Roman Empire. They go east. In fact, St. Thomas goes to India, into Kerala, and then St. Mark goes down into North Africa, and St. Paul, we know, especially because of Luke's history in the Acts and Paul's letters, he goes west. He goes into as far as Spain, and he goes into Italy and all of those places. So they're going all over the place because they're apostles. They're envoys. They're sent out to bring this good news, this victory proclamation of Christ's victory over death. So they're doing all of that, and they're establishing communities, churches or parishes, wherever they go. And the ones that perhaps if we read the New Testament scriptures, if we are familiar with the letters of St. Paul, we know about a few of these, or at least we kind of are familiar with the names. Names like Philippi, Thessalonica, and we know of Colossae, and then we know of Galatia, which is actually a province. It's not one place, but it's a whole province. We know about these names because we hear Galatians, Philippians, Colossians, all of those. But those parishes never went away. They're still here today. They continued worshiping. They continued existing. They continued doing what they were doing for the last 2,000 years. Yeah, especially after the 1400s, that existence took a turn sharply for the worse when there were invasions and then there was persecution, but they continued, and they continue to this day. So for the Greek Orthodox, this Eastern kind of half of Christianity, for us, these aren't just communities that are sort of named in a book and they're sort of abstract, and we think, well, we know that there was, you know, Corinth somewhere. Our people are from these parishes. They're the descendants of those who were taught by Paul. And so this is that living continuity. Now, in the history of Christianity, they weren't called Christians at first. I mean, you may know this if you've read the book of Acts. You know, at first they simply followed what they called the way. And if you went to one of them in the first century and you said to one of these, what we now call Christians, excuse me, are you a Christian? They say, what's a Christian? Because they didn't know. They identified as Jews. They identified as Jews who followed this particular way of this Christ. And so they continued to worship at the temple until about 70 AD with the destruction of the temple. And when the temple was destroyed, the communities that worshiped there, what we now call the Jewish community and the Christian communities, even though that's anachronistic, they had to figure out, what are we going to do? Because that was their life. We read in the book of Acts, they were continually going up into the temple for prayer. And so what they did was they went home. And not just went home, but they went into their homes. Now, the temptation is we think, okay, they went into their homes, and their homes look just like ours. You know, there's a foyer, there's a living room, there's a kitchen table, and they all just kind of hung around the kitchen table singing, I don't know what, Kumbaya, you know, gather us in, whatever it is. But no. The Roman home, the wealthy Roman home, and we know they were wealthy because, for example, Priscilla, who was one of these patronesses of the church, she sold murex dye, and that was money in the bank. That was huge. In these homes, it was a space that was liturgically set out. Yes, it was a civic liturgy, but it was a liturgy. It was a performed act that had specific expectations, because when you came into a Roman home, you come into an entryway, a vestibule, and then there's an atrium with a beautiful skylight, and there are portraits of the family members from that are significant from the previous generations, and then at the far end, there's a closed-off space that can be opened where there's a table, and the head of the family would sit there, and people would come and ask him for help, and this three-part layout mimicked the temple layout perfectly. So it was uniquely situated for the Christians to continue to do what they knew, which was temple worship. And so they continued this, albeit in a Christian mode, and their life was centered around what we call the Eucharist, or Holy Communion, the reception of what the Christians have always taught to be the bread and the wine becoming the body and blood, because they believed this was an eternal sacrifice. Why do I say all this? Well, because that pattern continued, and it continued even after the legalization of Christianity. You have that on your timeline, front page. The legalization of Christianity was not the adoption of Christianity as the state religion by Constantine, Emperor St. Constantine. That is a frequently attested error. He simply issued an edict of toleration. He said everybody can worship. Nobody's going to be persecuted for how they worship anymore. And so he ended that persecution of including Christians. And as a way of making it up to the Christians, who had suffered pretty horribly for the first few centuries of their existence at the hand of the Romans, he gave them certain public buildings. We call them basilicas. Because that word, vasilevs, vasilikis, that has that meaning of royal, a royal building. Well, when they came in, they found them perfectly situated, again, for what they were doing. They ended up putting in what we call like a templon or an architrave at the front. They had the altar. They had an entryway. They had the Holy of Holies. But then they also had the holy place as they knew it. And for the Christians, what they were teaching and what they realized in this was that as the people came in, as the faithful came in, they were all standing as the priesthood. They were all standing as the royal priesthood, offering the sacrifice of praise. And this continued then. Now, how do we know that this continued? Well, it's very simple. When the legalization of Christianity happened, they had an existing liturgy. You can't create that out of whole cloth. You can't simply say, well, Bob, we're legalized now. Could you come up with a liturgy by Sunday, because the emperor is really excited? That doesn't happen, no. They continued to worship the way they already knew, but it expanded in public, and it became enriched and beautified. And so we continue to this day. In fact, we just closed down yesterday evening. Am I right, Woody? We closed down a 6-part discussion of the history of the development of the divine liturgy, the Eucharistic service of the Orthodox Church. And it continued and it continued. But in addition to that continuity of worship, the churches had to have a continuity of teaching. And because of that, they had a number of deliberative councils. You'll see them if you look at your handout. Those councils were actually patterned off of the scriptural image of the apostles meeting in council in Jerusalem, the first church, which exists still to this day. They met there to deliberate how converts should be received into the faith. It was a big controversy at the time. And they deliberated as a group, and they delivered the pronouncement. And to this day, that's how we decide controversies. The church leadership comes together, they deliberate in council, and then they deliver the pronouncement. And so there were several of those, and I will condense those 7 councils into a very simple formula that they were particularly interested to protect. That God is one in 3 persons. They were teaching that God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that the 3 are one in being, but they are distinct. They were also interested to teach that Jesus Christ is that second person, the Son of God, become a human being, and that he is fully God, everything it is to be God, and simultaneously, fully human, everything it is to be human, lacking nothing of either one. That's it. I just condensed what was probably 1,000 years of acrimony and argumentation into like 2 sentences. So, that's the deliberation. What are the implications of this, of God becoming human and calling us to be with himself? And so, for this period, they're working that out. And they've got a lot of philosophers and learned people, which always complicate things. So all of these councils are happening in the East. In the West, in the Latin tradition, which was part of this family, they didn't have that issue. They were largely unaffected by these. Occasionally, the Bishop of Rome would write and he would support the position of the church. And the Syriac church, these were the 3 main sort of language families. Syriac, of course, was close to Aramaic. The Syriac church also weighed in from North Africa and from the Asia Minor and up into the Middle East. They would weigh in too. Unfortunately, and I'll close with this just to give you a very brief overview, that Syriac church family broke away from the rest of Christianity in about the 6th century. You'll see a Council of Chalcedon. That was the nail in the coffin. Latin and Greek Christianity continued apace for another, 500 to 1,000 years, depending on how you want to date it. Now, I will say this. The one thing that you perhaps think that you might know is wrong. 1054, 1054 is not the date of the schism, not by a long shot. Why? Because that is the date one individual excommunicated another individual. It had no bearing on the rest of the church. It really wouldn't progress for another 400 years, the process of division between the Latin church and the Greek church. And now, conventionally, we call the Latin church the Roman Catholic Church because they're based in Rome. We call the Eastern Church, the Greek Orthodox Church, because our historical, liturgical, theological language is Greek. The same Greek, in fact, that the New Testament was written in, has nothing to do with the modern nation state of Greece. That's only 200 years old. We're 2,000 years old, so we win. Thank you.
10 minutes. You're good.
They're going to have questions. No. I think we will. Let's just have all three of you, and then we'll open it up. So I think, Lori, since we have Orthodox Christianity, there was a movement within Protestantism, and then we moved to that. So Lori's congregation comes out of the Protestant tradition. So maybe we'll let you give us some of your
Jerry. And now for something completely different is where we're at. So I've discovered that I'm a person of metaphor, and I discovered that what I am wearing is how I feel about Christianity today and what we represent. This was not planned. But I literally looked down and I am wearing almost entirely gray, and that is my tradition. It is a bunch of shades of gray. I am possibly the worst person to speak for all of Christianity. Not because I'm me, but because my tradition is A, very small, and B, very much on a progressive liberal scale on one end. So just know that. My particular tradition also is one that, unlike Father's, if you go to my United Church of Christ congregation, you will experience one thing. If you go to the next closest one at 71st in Pennsylvania, you will experience something completely different, because every local church is its own highest authority. So we agree to be in communion or in covenant with one another, but there is very little consistency among our different congregations, which makes it a wee bit problematic to tell you what Protestantism is about. But we will do our best. So we'll fast forward to Martin Luther, 1517. Martin Luther is frustrated with the Roman church. Oh, let me also say, we have way more in common than we have indifference. Okay, so the other metaphor for Christianity that I'm going to give is like cartons of ice cream. We are all cartons of ice cream. There are a bazillion flavors of ice cream. There are at least that many flavors of Christianity. So for any of us to speak of a particular part of Christianity is really just one flavor, and we have to understand that. It might happen to be my favorite, and I might think it's the best, and it might taste awful to you and still be Christianity. So I know that's irritating, but it is the reality of Christianity. So Father here is Greek tradition. I'm hanging out in the Western tradition. The Roman Catholics are doing their thing, and there are some who are not happy with that. There are some very fine details to that conversation, but essentially a group of people, including Martin Luther, said, we are going to protest the way that things are moving forward. That's where our name comes from. We are a movement based out of protest. So Protestantism happens because of a desire to reform what was the Catholic Church. We aren't trying to start something completely different. We actually love the church. We just have some issues with some details in it. And then there come about a zillion branches from that. So we break into Lutheran and Methodist and Presbyterian. I'm with the United Church of Christ. And we just continue splintering. In most of Protestant traditions, you can find splits over race. You can find splits over gender, who can be ordained and who cannot. You will now, in recent times, the split is over GLBTQ communities. All of those splits can be traced, and almost all of us have those fractures in our communities. My particular community, the United Church of Christ, formed in 1957, so we are quite new. And by community, I mean our entire denomination, so the larger group, not just my local church. 1957 is when two denominations came together that used to be four. That makes zero difference. The oldest of those was the Pilgrims, your Mayflower Pilgrims. So a very stoic, a very rule-bound people. And they eventually evolved, is the word that I'm going to use, and they looked around and they said, we can do more if we're united rather than being separate. And so in 1957, they looked at each other and said, we have some differences. Some of us like to do baptism this way. Some of us like to do communion that way. Some of us think we should be focused on the Trinity. Some of us think we should be focused on a lot of history. We never agree. And we just simply said, none of us are going to survive if we're that tiny. So why don't we agree to have this community of people come together and we will practice in the ways that we see fit for our local communities. What that means is my community in Carmel, Indiana, is quite different than my community where I grew up in Muskego, Wisconsin. My particular denomination does not have an international presence. So I don't have churches in Africa or churches in Europe or churches in South America. We have American churches. We might do partnerships. We might go over and hang out with somebody and see how they are doing Christianity locally, but we aren't starting churches in another location. Most of our congregations are very much influenced by the culture around them. When I was in school at Butler University, my thesis was on the Africanization of Christianity after studied abroad, and I did a parallel study of the Indianapolization of Christianity. The simplest example of that is, if it's race weekend in May, churches in Speedway are closed. We laugh, but the reality is if you can't get to church, you're not going to open the doors. So you just make it so. You say, we can't worship on Sunday, on race day, in Indianapolis, in Speedway. So we move worship to another time. All of our congregations do that in one way or another. Some of them are easier to see. Okay? The United Church of Christ is known, as I said, as a fairly liberal, usually quite liberal, denomination. We were the first to ordain women, the first to ordain GLBTQ folks, and a series of other firsts along the way. But since we have this deal where our local congregation is the highest authority, there is zero consistency. So what we stand for is different depending on where you're at. What we agree upon is we are experiencing the stories of Jesus. We are looking at Scripture. That's a broad definition of Scripture. And we are trying to live in a way that changes lives for the better. It is intentionally just that ambiguous. I think I might leave it there. Is that fair? You want to know anything else, Father? We'll go with that.
Thank you. Well, and I appreciate Lori's identifying that, you know, there were many different breaks that were seen very hard, very rigid, because you were pushing against one another all through the ages. But what's evolved is we've really come to realize all those things that we were fighting about really were pretty insignificant. Actually, we had some churches that broke off of one another because of the argue about carpeting in the church. You know, so it wasn't always theological things. It was people got mad on something and they started a new church. Yeah, that's right. So, and this is in all of our faith traditions. I mean, if we get, you know, you can have people talk about in Islam who are Sunni and Shia and all the and different ones. So, but I do appreciate, I think, just the how much more we do have in common, but that process of that, this is difficult to try to pinpoint different speakers to speak in this. Last year we had, on the Mormon tradition, we had some different ones, and so I did want, because the Greek Orthodox, and I think you have some questions, as I did, and for Father Lucas and maybe out of the Protestants and for Lori. And then, because I didn't know much about the Christian Church Scientists, this is kind of a newer one, so I said, let's have lunch, and Sharon, I'm going to ask you some sound like ignorant questions, which is, that's the best way to do, is just to say, I got something that seems pretty silly, but, you know, what's a practitioner? I don't even know what that is, you know? And so we just began that, and Sharon has such a wonderful spirit. Many of you probably know the Christian Science Monitor, right? That's a magazine. That's their magazine. And so anyhow, we'll let Christian, I'll let you turn it over.
I don't look like the youngest kid on the block, but compared to these guys, I probably really am. I'm going to move just a little bit closer to these books, which I might refer to. Okay, all right. I'm obviously, of course, not this incredible speaker that these guys are. You guys are a hard act to follow, but at any rate, I'm delighted to be here to talk about Christian Science. And one of the things that I'd love to establish right off the bat is that Christian Science is Christian. It's very Bible, very, very Bible-based. It's anchored in the Bible. As a matter of fact, our first tenet is, as adherents of truth. We take the inspired word of the Bible as our inherent guide to eternal life. And so we are rooted in the Bible. Mary Baker Eddy was born in 1821, and she was born into a very humble farm family in New Hampshire. And it was very Bible-based. Oh, my goodness, they had the Bible for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. As a matter of fact, her parents wanted her and her brothers and sisters to not only learn the Bible, but to memorize the Bible. But Mary Baker Eddy loved the Bible. She didn't consider it a duty. It became a companion. As a matter of fact, it became a best friend. And the reason being that it was comfort to her, was guidance to her, was strength to her. In the first half of Mary Baker Eddy's life, who is the discoverer and founder of Christian Science, she was chronically ill. She had many trials and challenges. She lost her husband. She was pregnant. She was unable to keep her son because at that time she was ill, and she could not financially support him. And so her son was taken by a family to another state. Many times during those middle years of her life, she was just right on the door of poverty. Sometimes she didn't even know where her next meal was going to come. In 1866, she was in Lynn, Massachusetts, and she slipped on the ice in such a way that the attending doctors and her friends thought she was going to pass on. The third day after that accident, she picked up a Bible, and she turned to the Gospel, Mark chapter 3, and she read and had the inspiration that her life was spirit. And with that, she was absolutely, totally healed. She got up, she got dressed, she walked into the next room and just bowled over the doctors and her friends who thought she was about ready to pass on. Well, this began for her a spiritual journey. And for 3 years, she just kind of got into a very, very quiet place and studied. The Bible was her textbook, and she was looking for that positive rule that had healed her instantaneously. She felt that it was what the Christ must have been doing, because the Christ was doing so much healing during his life, healing the deaf and the dumb and the withered hand, and those who were dead, feeding the multitudes, walking on water. She felt that there must be a positive rule. And so over the course of a few years, she discovered Christian Science, and she wrote the book, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures. So what is Christian Science? What is this book, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures? And what is a Christian Science God? What does Christ Jesus have to do in the Christian Science religion? And what about us? What about man in the Christian Science faith and tradition? Well, let's start with the words Christian Science. That was the name Mrs. Eddy gave her discovery. And it's really very simple. It's Christian because it talks about the life of Christ, Christ healing, the Christ tradition of healing. and science, because Mrs. Eddy felt that there was a fundamental divine law operating in the universe, just like the law of medicine or the law of mathematics, the law of music, that there was a fundamental divine law. It was a science, and it could be proved just as the Christ had proved it. And when Mrs. Eddy was actually going through this spiritual journey of discovering Christian Science and writing the textbook, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures, she was healing as she went along. Now, this book, Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures, does not take the place of the Bible in science and health. It is exactly what it says. It's the key to the Scriptures. It just sheds light on the Scriptures. It helps you see the spiritual import of the Scriptures, because it's the spiritual import that meant the world to Mrs. Eddy. You know, one of the things that has helped me understand this way of seeing things spiritually, there is a Christian Science practitioner who lives in California and in Ireland. And he was in Ireland and with his wife, and they were wanting to go to another little village, and so they walked up to one of the villagers standing there, and who was Irish, and said, how do you get here? And he said, well, if I were to be going there, I wouldn't be starting from here. And I love that, because that helps me understand that you can't really understand spirit by looking at the five material senses. You really have to lift and look through a spiritual lens. And that's what Christian Science asks you to do. It asks you to look through a spiritual lens. So what about the Christian Science God? You know, I wasn't always a Christian Scientist. I was raised in the Christian church. As a matter of fact, I attended Northwood Christian Church, which is at 46th and Central. I don't know if you know Dr. Fisher at the time. He was my minister, and I loved him. I loved that church. But I discovered the Christian Science God, and it was just absolutely phenomenal. It blew me away, and it drew me to the Christian Science tradition. Mrs. Eddy starts Science and Health, the very first line says, to those leaning on the sustaining infinite, today is big with blessings. And then she starts her first chapter, which is on prayer, communing with that spiritual oneness. She says, the prayer that reforms the sinner and heals the sick is an absolute faith that all things are possible to God, a spiritual understanding of him, an unselfed love. So this sustaining infinite, this God that all things are possible to, that's the God that drew me, and it's the God that has kept me. It's the same God that you find in Isaiah. I am God, there is none else, there is no God beside me. And it's a God that can heal. Christ Jesus, how do Christian Scientists see Christ Jesus? Well, we just go to the Gospels, and Christ Jesus understood the divine principle, the divine science that was operating, and that's what enabled the Christ to heal so convincingly and so certainly. He was convinced of God's allness and of God's goodness and of God's might and of God's power. And what about us? What about man? Well, in Christian Science, Mrs. Eddy takes us to Genesis 1. Genesis 1 kind of permeates all of Christian Science teaching, because it talks about this almighty, infinite God, but it talks about man made in the image and likeness of God, a man that has dominion over all the earth. And then Mrs. Eddy also notes that God saw everything that he had made, and he said it was very good. So that man is not only spiritual, made in God's image and likeness, but man is holy, totally, truly good. You know, Mrs. Eddy was asked once by a journalist what the fundamental truths of her church were. And she said, well, it's based on the Ten Commandments, the 91st Psalm, the Beatitudes, and the Book of Revelation. So she just had kept this rooting and grounding in the Bible. It very much permeated this book, Science and Health. She then, in 1894, made the Bible and Science and Health the pastor of her church. And so the book that preaches in the Christian Science Church, the two books, are Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures and the Bible. It's an impersonal, and it embraces everyone. It leaves no one out. And the cool thing about having these two books be your pastor is that you can take it to bed with you. You can get up in the morning and have it with your coffee. You can take it to work. If you feel sick, or if you're having a problem, or your child comes home and he's been in a fight, or my husband actually took the Bible and Science and Health to war with him, a small set, and it meant the world. It was wonderful, as it always is. Mrs. Eddy's church that she established in 1879 is a church that's democratic. And there are about 2,000 branches worldwide. And so for our services, we have lesson sermons. And you've been given a handout. And the handout lists 26 topics. And so twice a year, we go through those topics. And the wonderful thing about having a lesson sermon for a week is that you get to study the sermon at home. And then you get to come to church and hear it read. At a Christian Science church, we are a lay ministry, and so we have people who are elected to serve. We have a first reader who reads and Science and Health and conducts services, and we have a second reader who reads the Bible. A Christian Science service is also permeated with the Bible. It starts off with scriptural readings. It goes to the Lord's Prayer. And you'll also see that I've given you a handout of the Lord's Prayer with its spiritual interpretation, that we have silent prayer, and then we say the Lord's Prayer with its spiritual interpretation by Mary Baker Eddy. And then we have the lesson sermon. We conclude every service by reading 1 John 3, 1 through 3, which talks about man and man's spiritual journey to perfection, really, and what is forever lying ahead as we are living our eternal life right now. Then it also ends with a benediction. One of the things that Jerry mentioned was the Christian Science Monitor. Mrs. Eddy has a publishing society. Now, here is a woman who, in her day, when a woman didn't even have the right to vote, she started an international faith tradition and a publishing society that publishes four different publications: a weekly Christian Science Sentinel, a monthly Christian Science Journal, the quarterly lesson sermons, and the Herald, which is a publication that goes out to those international languages, and there are many of those. I think Science and Health is, Virginia, 17? 18 languages now. So that, too, is through the Publishing Society. The Christian Science Monitor, if you're familiar with the Christian Science Monitor, is a newspaper that was founded by Mrs. Eddy in 1908. And the motto, the motive for the Christian Science Monitor is to injure no man but to bless all mankind. And if you've ever read the Monitor, it doesn't dodge the news or the issues, but it does look for very practical, positive solutions. It's won 7 Pulitzer Prizes, and it has run scores, dozens of foreign press awards. The Christian Science Reading Room, I don't want to forget that, because if you've ever passed a Christian Science Reading Room, you might have gone, what is a Christian Science Reading Room? We get the question a lot, but we welcome you to come in. It's at 21 West Main Street here in Carmel for our church, and it is a place where you can purchase Christian Science literature, or you can sit, pray, study, meditate, or have a conversation with the librarian. You would be welcome to do that. At any rate, that about wraps us up. We have some similarities, certainly.
Well, thank you so much for the questions and for your sharing of some aspects of your different traditions. And we'll certainly have opportunities after we finish to come up and ask them questions as well. But let's give them our appreciation for being here tonight.